Below them are serious person behind the screen. So, second series or seasons, depending on your persuasion, are always tricky to pull off. Done well, they can provide a natural and earned expansion of the world and characters we were introduced to in the first series, but done poorly, they can undermine that first series and disappoint fans of the show. With this in mind, I'm back again talking about Derry Girls, which is always fun to do. The show has just wrapped up its second season, and I think it's safe to say it's been a tremendous success. Now, while the first series was airing, there was very little publicity or buzz surrounding it. Many people like myself loved it week after week, and the show garnered a loyal fan base, but it was nothing compared to the buzz surrounding the second series. Excitement was at fever pitch in the weeks leading up to broadcast. The cast were appearing on a multitude of talk shows, the show was regularly getting featured in magazines, even making the cover of The Big Issue. The girls were featured on billboards around the UK and Ireland, and the show even got its own mural in Derry itself, showing just how much of an impact that first series made. When the first series aired, no one else I knew watched it. But luckily, after I published my video, thanks for the response on that one, by the way, you guys rock, I managed to get most of my friends caught up, and we were all counting down the days until we got to pay a visit to Derry again. So, with all this publicity and the added hype for Series 2, what could go wrong? Well, I began to get very nervous a couple of days before the series premiered. Oh god, what if they can't live up to the brilliance of Series 1? What if they crack under the pressure to deliver a worthy follow-up? But as I sat down to watch Across the Barricade, my worries were immediately put to rest, as the energy and performances I loved in the first series were still there and in droves. Yes indeed, Derry Girls 2 proved to be an incredibly entertaining and worthy follow-up, with each adding a genuine highlight of the week. Lisa McGee proved once again with the series that she is a genius. How my best friend and I even bought t-shirts not long after the first episode aired, which, if anything, shows how loyal the fanbase has become, considering that the artist who designed those shirts based on what the girls wear in episode 1 of the new series did so only a week after the episode aired. I just couldn't get enough of the show this year. The cast are impeccable, nobody gives a bad performance, and you get the feeling that the five leads have really settled into their roles now. I haven't seen the cast play off each other this well with this level of chemistry on television since The Inbetweeners over a decade ago. They are magnetic, and the best scenes of the show are often the ones where the girls and James are just interacting with each other and talking, often about stuff that isn't completely relevant to the plot of the episode. This stuff makes me wonder how much of these scenes were improvised, because they feel so incredibly natural and, above all, real. And I guess real is a good word to describe the show as a whole. Now, as I mentioned in my Series 1 video, I am not Irish and I definitely didn't grow up during the Troubles, and so I'm not going to pretend that I know how authentic Derry Girls is when it comes to its representation of the way people interact, traditions that take place, or certain major events that took place in the 90s. As such, I'm not going to dwell on this point for long simply because I don't feel I have the right to. It isn't my place. But from what I can gather from people who do have a connection to this time, Derry Girls is an incredibly sensitive and authentic show, capturing the feeling of these things perfectly. Now, like I said, I don't personally feel like I can comment on this, but I can tell from the beautiful closing scenes of episodes 5 and 6 that there is great care taken in how these pivotal moments are brought to the screen, and how these real events impact the fictional characters of the show. Incidentally, those scenes now take on even more poignancy following the tragic events that struck Derry recently, just weeks after these episodes aired. One thing I do feel equipped to talk about, however, is how genuine the show feels. It's littered with these wonderful human moments that I think everyone can relate to in one way or another. Little things that just make these characters feel so real. Now, there are some spoilers going forward, so be warned, but Erin being stood up by John Paul only for James to ditch his Doctor Who night and take her to the prom itself is just so damn sweet. To be honest, I had a theory going on in my head during my fifth watch through of Series 1, I think, that Erin did have a little crush on James, and because of this scene, people are calling for the two to get together in Series 3. Now, I wouldn't mind this at all. In fact, it'd probably provide a great little relationship and a new twist and a dynamic. But part of me would kind of like nothing to come of this. The scene in question just acts as a nice example of the group being friends, caring for one another, and part of me feels that may be somewhat diluted if a romantic element is introduced, but as I say, I really don't mind either way. This, combined with smaller stuff like the girls buying their prom dresses, dancing to Rock the Boat, and musing over a local wave machine, this just makes everyone's lives feel so authentic. And I'd argue that Series 2, more so than Series 1, feels so mined from Lisa McGee's own experiences growing up, and it's both fascinating and hilarious to watch these friends navigate their lives. As I've said, all of the returning cast members are stellar, and there's one in particular who got a bit more focus this time around, the wonderful Siobhan McSweeney as Sister Michael. Her deadpan and sarcastic performance is one of the highlights of the entire show, and she rightly got her place among the gang in most of the marketing for the series. Another big part of the show that I can't believe I didn't mention last time, the killer soundtrack. Filled with 90s tunes, the music is a big part of why the setting, feels so authentic. With an eclectic mix of genres, the music is just terrific, and I personally think that Series 2 had a better soundtrack than Series 1. Though that could just be down to the fact that there are more songs by the Cranberries used here. They're one of my absolute favourite bands, and aside from Dreams, which is essentially the Derry Girls theme song at this point, songs from their back catalogue accompany quite a lot in this time around, including the aforementioned ending of Episode 5 and Mr. Brin's entrance in Episode 2. That was a particular highlight for me, as it used my favourite song from the band, I Can't Be With You. The series also demonstrated that the show knows when to not go too far for the sake of its own comedy. For example, Episode 3 is based around the girls trying to get to a concert in Belfast after reports of an escaped polar bear caused the adults to stop them from going. A lesser show would end up clumsily showing the animal jumping the shark and stretching the credibility for the sake of comedy. Lisa McGee clearly knows that this wouldn't work for such a grounded show and cleverly takes advantage of not being able to show it. The humour comes from the paranoia that the polar bear is going to come around the corner at any minute and the characters' reactions to the news. And just when you think you're going to see the animal, the show pulls the rug out from under you in a way which I find gut-bustingly funny. In fact, the whole of Episode 3 might be the funniest episode of a show I've seen in a long while. It was perfection. Now, the series wasn't perfect. I found Episode 4 to be quite disappointing, though that might be because a lot of the jokes about Irish weddings and funerals were a little lost on me, and some jokes did outstay their welcome. For example, Sarah obsessing over Kathy Maguire's eyebrows just didn't need to be as long as it was. I think Series 1 is probably the strongest selection of episodes, but that's not to say Series 2 was bad at all. It definitely lived up to the hype, and let's be honest, it's going to take a lot to beat Series 1. But at the end of the day, I think what Series 2 proved was that Derry Girls is simply about people. When you strip everything away, you see that the series shows we're all the same in the end. The show observes ordinary people as they just live in extraordinary times. The show is really just about living, and I'm willing to bet that everybody can see themselves as one of the characters. Really, everyone is in Derry Girls. The writing shows us that often what happens externally, whatever chaos is going on in the world, it all affects us more than we're aware, because it isn't just a physical thing. In times of crisis, we become closer to one another. It may not seem like it, but we all end up looking out for each other and being there for each other. In this respect, Derry Girls will forever be a timeless, special show that will hopefully resonate with generations for years to come, because, to borrow a phrase, we have to be brave. We have to live. Or I could just be completely overanalyzing the show and all that mean nothing, but for real, I firmly believe Derry Girls is something special, and in the current political climate around the world, it's something we really need right now. It's an exceptionally well-written, hilarious, quotable, heartfelt show, and is definitely one of, if not the best thing on TV currently. Series 2 has given us 6 more episodes that I will certainly watch and rewatch again and again, just as I did last year with the first series. I just love these characters so much, and I can't wait to see what's next for them. We now know a third series is coming sometime next year, and Lisa has said she has an ending for the story in mind. There are strong rumours of a movie also, which I'm wary of. TV to film adaptations rarely go well, and hopefully if this does happen, it'll turn out more like the Inbetweeners movies than Keith Lemon the film. God. We'll see what happens in the future, but I have faith that whenever we see the girls next, we'll be treated to the same high standard present in these first 2 wonderful, wonderful series. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you in my next one.